Hi, good afternoon, everyone. So I know it's a 4:45 and nice weather, so I'll be very quick so that you all can enjoy your evening in Prague. Well, I'm going to present the result survey on the payment methods by OA journal publishers, so mainly OA Spy members. So yeah, as Matt mentioned just now, I'm doing my thesis for MBA. So this survey was facilitated by Playada Management Consultancy, Amsterdam based, and also I was supervised by Matt and also Caroline from OESPA. How this survey was done? So basically the survey was done by online survey actually. So the content of my presentation would be the result of the survey, which consists of participating OA publishers and journals. And I will divide the result between publisher with APC journals and without, and also all publishers with other type of funding. And lastly, the summary and also conclusion of the survey. So, the survey was sent to 53 OESPA members, but out of this, 26 responded to the survey. And out of these 26 publishers, they represent 591 OA journals, which out of 591, 472 with APC, which are published by 11 OA publishers. And the rest, 119, which represent about 20%, are without APC. So the next result, as I said, will be the next slide will consist of the result only for publishers with APC. The average APC for these 11 publishers is 926, and these figures are expressed in US dollars. Yeah. The lowest APC average is 482, and the highest average APC is 1,433. So the range, with the lowest APC is only $100, and the highest was still is $2,900. So also we asked a few questions about institutional membership program. So out of 11 members with APC, 9 of them have membership program. The other 2 don't have. So out of these 9 publishers with membership program, 6 have implemented a full coverage of the fee, 4 partial coverage of auto fee, and also we have with a different institutional membership program, which are 2 types, and we also asked some open questions with regard to institutional membership program. What are the benefits would be? And basically, benefit from institutional membership program seems to be rather limited. This is according to the response that I received. 3 mention more submission, whereas the other 2 mention promotional effect. And the others did not mention that this program gave a little bit more benefit to them. And as of for libraries, this is from publisher's perspective, yeah, for librarians here. It's a good tool for promoting OA within their institutes. And also, of course, benefit for both is that less of administrative burden, which also have been mentioned by the 3 publishers earlier. And so what are the challenges for OA publishers? Some mentioned that the challenges is to set up an administrative system to track the publication, especially for those smaller publishers. And for the libraries, their main challenges would be the budgetary problem, and also the difficulty to manage this open-ended characteristic of the program. The next question was about waiver policy. So of these 11 publishers, all of them, yes, they do have waiver policy. So what are the types of their waiver policy? 5 have implemented a discretionary waiver, 4 with a promotional waiver, one with a discretionary discount and one promotion discount, and also two mentioned that they do have other types of waiver policy. For instance, I could mention like less income countries and all those things. And this one, we asked also a question about do the publishers take measure to ensure that the publication fee model does not pose a potential conflict of interest during the editorial process? 10 out of 11 say yes, they have a measure in place, where another one say they don't have any specific measure for that. And the next one, the next result will be for all the publishers. We also asked about their funding. So 4 out of 11 publishers have no other types of funding for their journal with APC. And this one, the next one, 9 publishers, which is quite interesting result, they are with journal without APC. They also have no other type of funding. So yeah, I don't know how to survive. So most of other types of funding consists of the following. So basically 10 by scholarly societies, 7 by public organizations, 4 by corporate sponsoring. And of course, a few publishers, they do have additional sources of income. 6 mentioned they do have income from advertising, 3 from print edition, 2 submission fees, and 1 mentioned that subscription-based access to a non-research content.
Are all those numbers out of 11? Are this all from just the APC publishers?
Which one? 4 out of 11, yes.
All the numbers are out of 11, right?
Yeah. So with regard to the greatest financial challenges, this is also, we pose an open question, so I received lots of feedback, so it could be summarized as follows. It's quite a struggle now to find funding for APC, so publishers are pleading for more OA funds, and some also are asking support from research funding organizations. And in the social science and humanities, APC seems to be a great hurdle that nobody wants to sponsor that. And finally, I also see that some respondents appear to oppose to APC and they look for other funding options. So this result will be, again, the result from publishers with like APC only. 80% of OA journals, who are their OA SPA members of course, that are with APC, and the average 1433 with the range 100 to 2900. Even though the institutional membership programs are widespread nowadays, they are seen as not yet, I put it there, very beneficial to publishers. And like I said earlier, the main challenge is to set up the article tracking system. Waiver policies are also now widespread, but still many mentioned that struggle to find funding for APC. And of course, majority of APC publishers, they have other types of funding and also additional types of income sources to sustain. So this is our other result that appeared from the study. This one that I mentioned earlier, 9 publishers without any type of funding, without APC, but so probably they have funding from elsewhere within the institutes. So with regard to other types of funding, yeah, mostly from the sponsoring or subsidies, and some are also from corporate, and other mentioned also from advertising, print edition, submission fees, subscription-based access to non-research content. Yep, thank you very much for your attention.
So do we have any questions?
Yeah.
Anna?
Hi. Thanks. Yeah, on your second to last slide, you mentioned that the average APC was $1,433.
Mm-hmm.
But on the previous slide, it was $926. Can you just explain to me again why that is $926 of the stars?
This one?
Yeah.
1, 4, 3. I'm sorry, can you repeat the question again? The average?
I think I know the answer to that. Yeah. I think what it is on the survey, Anwar asked each of us as a publisher, on the survey, we publishers who completed this said what our average charge was at our publishing house. So I think what he's saying there, if this is correct, that the lowest average at a publishing house was 482,
correct.
And the highest average at a publishing house was 1,443.
Yes.
So that, but the average across all of us was the, is it 1177? Whatever, the second.
1433.
Yeah. We're not as cheap as I thought. I'd like to make a comment just from OWASPA's perspective.
Mm-hmm.
I just want to make it very clear that in engaging in taking a look at these article processing charges and mechanisms related to those, we don't in any way want to say we're going to push for everybody to introduce APCs. We recognize the vast majority of journals today do not have article processing charges, but nonetheless, we know that a number of us do, and so we do need to have some kind of practical and pragmatic solutions, as Paul was pointing out. This also came out of last year's conference, where there was a breakout session by types of groups, and the institutions and libraries, of which we had many, many more last year than we do this year, came back with this as a suggestion. They'd like us to take a look at this and how we might work together and to clean up some of the mechanisms. So this is a really good first step for us to get an idea of what varieties we have out there and to try and work with that.
Thanks. Hi. Susan Murray from African Journals Online. I'm just wondering about those 9 journals that said that they didn't have any kinds of formal income.
Mm-hmm.
I agree with your surmise that it's probably institutional support and volunteerism. I was just wondering if you just off the top of your head remember what part of the world those journals are publishing from. Because in Africa we find that volunteerism is actually percentage-wise the single biggest fact that keeps journals publishing.
I can't remember by heart. Let me see. Yeah, okay, possible, because it's quite a new data, so I can't remember by heart. We just closed the survey like last week.
And we're having a breakout session tomorrow, which we're focusing on funding mechanisms, so it's a good opportunity for further discussion. And I think this survey has also produced, I think, some interesting qualitative kind of comments from the participants, and I think there'll be a lot of, you know, there's more to be mined from those responses. Okay.
Okay.
I think we're at 5:00 pretty much, so just to thank all the speakers for the funding session again.